So, for those of you who don't know me, I'm Dominic, and I work here at the Alternative Information and Development Center, called AIDC. And I've been given the honor of chairing this discussion today. I'm very excited to welcome all of our international guests, as well as those who have made the effort from Cape Town to come here today. I think, just to give you some background, AIDC, alongside partners internationally and locally, has put together a conference over this week looking at the crisis of politics and the political crisis. And I think not just to diagnose the crisis, but to search for new ways in which that we can respond to it. And so it's not just about the crisis, but it's also about the search for new emancipatory politics. And I think for that, it's important that we make the space as inclusive and as open as possible, so that as many people can contribute to a building of a new emancipatory politics and thinking of the strategies and perspectives that can carry it forward. So today, we thought it would be very important that we have a public forum, because unfortunately, the conference itself wasn't able to open up the spaces to as many people as we'd like. And so today, to give everyone a taste and flavor of some of the discussions and thinking that we've carried through the conference, we thought we'd try and bring it here, as well as to try and hear some of the reflections of others that we think would be able to add value in their contributions to the conference, but unfortunately, not enough space. So, alongside the new politics platform, today we have invited a number of what we think is very exciting speakers and activists from key sites of struggle across the world, including South America, Europe, North America, and very importantly, the African continent. And so, I take great pleasure in introducing some of the speakers that we'll have with us today. We have on the far right, not politically, Laura Flanders from the Laura Flanders.
I'm there, far left.
Yeah, you are the far left of it. It's all about the speaker. So, Laura from the USA, Ashok Subran from the Resistance and Alternatives from Mauritius, Pablo Solon, former Bolivian ambassador to the United Nations, and Hilary Wainwright from the editor of Red Pepper magazine in the UK. But of course, I mean, they are not the authority, and I'm sure they will agree with me. And I think that there's many, all of us in this room are able to contribute meaningfully to the development and the carrying out of the new politics. So I think it's important that we are able to contribute, and I think many of us are able to do so. So I asked each of the speakers to speak for 10 to 15 minutes, after which we will open it up to the floor for comments, questions, and contributions. After which the panelists can add comments and final remarks, and then hopefully we'll be able to carry this discussion forward and will remain here through the rest of the week, and moreover, generally in our different regions as we try and carry forward new politics. Thank you. First, we ask Laura to speak. By the way, this thing is a catch box, a microphone thing, so we can throw it around to whoever wants to speak. Anybody who has a pacemaker in, try and keep it as far away as possible, because there are magnets here.
Oh, no, that's true. It's not that.
Yeah,
true.
I'm not joking. So there's a magnet here, and it can maybe maybe we can put a.
conversation that I hope that you will help us to continue, because that will be what makes the politics actually new, as opposed to the same old, same old. So I come from the United States. I'm a media activist and a journalist. I've covered social movements and grassroots organizations. I try to bring to the public attention in the United States new models for the politics and organizing and culture and activism. But nonetheless, even those of us who operate inside the U.S. media, but as independents, even those of us who operate inside the U.S., I should say, as independent media activists and media critics, we do sometimes get affected by the traditional media, the money media atmosphere. So just to remind myself, on election night, even those of us who were very skeptical of the conventional version of events and of the history and the current state of things in the United States, even those of us who were very skeptical of money media and conventional wisdom, even we, I think, on election night were surprised by what happened. Now, in saying that, it is true that the United States political class, especially the white American political class, the mainstream media, which you may have heard, somewhat close to the white American political class, have an extraordinary capacity for shock and surprise and self-pity. So the version that we got, the news that we got after the election, the version of reality was, the sky is falling, the sky is falling. We are in a new phenomenon. This is, you know, as bad as slavery, as bad as ISIS. I mean, if you had listened to the reporting, you would think the sky had fallen in. So just as a little bit of reality, in the United States, we have more than 92 million people who are eligible to vote and who do not vote. So about just over 40% of the population do not vote. So in every state, but 8 states, had somebody called Do Not Vote been running, they would have gotten more votes than both Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. They would have won in all but 8 states. So a little bit of a reality check as to who actually voted in this election and who decided it. It is true that even within that context of how many people don't vote, the popular vote went to Hillary Clinton. You've all heard, 65 million, more than 65 million votes to Hillary Clinton, 62 million to Donald Trump. Our electoral college was what produced the vote. We can talk about that institution that was created in slavery to perpetuate this power of the slave states, the continuing effect and impact of our electoral college is devastating, and we have to get rid of it. All of that is not to say that there wasn't a reality reflected in the results of the election. So, was it the most shocking thing that had ever happened? No. I feel as if on my program, we started covering this election in 2008. Because you could see immediately in the reaction to the election of Barack Obama, the backlash that produced the situation, I believe, in which we find ourselves today, at least in large part. The growth of the Tea Party, which was in the Republican politics, we can discuss it. Was that new politics on the Republican side? In some ways, yes. It was certainly, I talk about it as a gateway drug for white supremacists into the mainstream of the Republican Party. And that was a development that certainly played out in this election. It's not new to say that there was a dislocated working class, that there's fragmentation on the American front, just as there's fragmentation in Europe, and the lack of, we were talking about today, a kind of pan-Europeanism had created a vacuum into which Brexit and some of the sort of more nationalist movements have emerged. In the US, the vast gap between rich and poor. We have 400 individuals with more wealth than 42 million people. The vast gap between rich and poor, the vast geographic gap between most of America and any media center, any center of opinion shaping, the huge gap between the agenda of working people, people of color, grassroots activists, environmentalists, and the agenda of either of our two traditional parties so big that there was no surprise in the fact that there was a vacuum to be filled. And no surprise, really, that there was a vacuum that was able to be filled by the kind of demagogue that was and is Donald Trump, a creature created out of our traditional media system. And who brilliantly knew how to deploy social media, rhetoric, abuse, insults, machismo, and frankly racism, to cast himself as a break with traditional liberalism and the traditional kind of blah, blah, blah culture of American politics. He presented himself as something new by showing, I will break with convention and be ruder than people normally are around women, around people of color, around immigrants. I will say outrageous things and be presented as a break with tradition. Because the tradition is going to be less outrageous if you can, at least in public. So, to me, it was not really a shock what happened. It was not really, in many ways, totally new. It was a function, in part, of a backlash against Barack Obama and a very significant analysis of the election. I mean, any deep analysis of the election
goes back to
the very literal suppression of the vote in many states. So Wisconsin was just one of 14 states that had new laws on the books around who could vote and what ID you needed to vote. That was a state where the Clinton-Trump difference was just about 27,000 votes. That was exactly the number of the margin of victory that Barack Obama had gained in one county of Milwaukee, which is a predominantly black community, where voting was way down in this election. So just one little shift in one county could have changed the results, and we'd be having a big, very different conversation about how irritated we are by neoliberal feminism and Hillary Clinton. Into this vacuum, an authoritarian movement has moved. Are the challenges that we face on the left new? Not really. The agenda of the Trump administration is surfacing some really exciting response. The agenda is not going down easily. Starting with the Women's March in January, which was the single largest day of protest in American history, with between 2 and 5 million people on the streets, reflected something we haven't seen in decades, the biggest ever demonstration in Los Angeles. And this was a demonstration focused on Washington, D.C. Huge, and the global component, huge, very important. As soon as Donald Trump's ban on immigration from seven majority Muslim countries was announced, you saw a spontaneous eruption of reaction and protest at the airports around the country, supported by some labor groups, but mobilized by social media. This last March 8th, we saw marches around International Women's Day in the U.S. that we've never seen. The U.S. typically does not celebrate International Women's Day. We have a Hallmark card holiday called Mother's Day, specifically not to happen on the same day as anything with a socialist kind of flavor. So the response has been real. It has been both fantastic and problematic in the sense that it is not organized by any kind of deep reservoir of organization in the United States. It's drawing on lots of strains of organization, but it does not reflect, if you're looking for new politics, I wouldn't say yet, but it represents any sort of reflection of institutional new politics. I think there's some style new politics, I think there are some relationships that are new. We're suddenly seeing women occupy, really they are the game in town, they are where the action is in terms of resistance, which is amazing, and it is not the white women's organizations, it is women of color, it is queer women, it is women with an international focus. One of the women who was the co-chair of the March on Washington is a Palestinian American who talks very forthrightly about Palestine,
yeah, Brian has one
which is brand new in the American women's movement. So I think the challenge that we're facing right now is that we have, oops, I'm standing on my own hat, is a big challenge. The challenge that we have in the United States is that we have an authoritarian agenda, which is very real. The day after the march, you saw the Trump administration reinstate the gag rule on any organization that wants to receive federal funding, the gag rule around abortion and reproductive rights, we talked about that. The determination around the ban has been a way to set up a conflict with the courts that is not being well handled. The first people that Donald Trump met with as president were the CIA. One of the second groups, the professional organizations he met with, was the Organization of Police and Sheriffs, which is a direct slap in the face to the movement around Black Lives Matter. And we can talk more about the sheriff's movement and its relationship to white patriot armed right-wing militia. So that I don't want to downplay how serious the Trump culture is and the Trump agenda could be if he gets away with it. But much of it is standard Republican agenda. Much of it is a pro-corporate agenda that we recognize. Much of it is a reduce taxes, reduce federal authority agenda, roll back civil rights, nothing new. We have some challenges in the resistance that a lot of what we're doing is new. A lot of what the relationships are that are reflected in the streets of the resistance are new relationships. And a lot of the politics is new in the sense that it is intersectional. It is complicated. It is picking components from the labor agenda, combining with components of the women's reproductive justice agenda to come up with the family labor rights agenda. It's connecting the violence against immigrants and Muslims with violence against African Americans and saying, can we have a new understanding of the meaning of sanctuary? It is learning from rural areas that have no media visibility, who have been the places where people have actually been working against the most violent, radical, white supremacist armed movements in the United States, more armed groups in the United States. So the very experts we need to hear from who have been doing that work are the furthest away from our media megaphones, are groups like the Mobile Organizing Project in Oregon, who are the experts. And how do you fight against the armed patriot movement, the armed white supremacist movement? Groups in the South, no media attention, the experts on how do you create a solidarity economy that can feed people and house people when they don't have work for whatever reason, the legacy of the civil rights movement. So I would say on the one hand, it's exciting that up against authoritarianism and an old agenda with some new ones, an agenda old enough to go back to white supremacy, slavery, patriarchy in America. We have a new resistance movement that is precisely new because of its pluralism. And that should be a positive. If we can make that pluralistic response to an authoritarian threat real and have institutional heft, then I think we will have been able to do more than just find a kind of silver lining in this nightmare, but really be able to realize some of our organizational dreams. So I look forward to hearing more from all of you, but that would be my take. Thanks.
I come from a small country nearby South Africa, 4 hours flight in South Africa. It's composed of several islands and many of the South Africans normally think about Mauritius as the colony holiday country. And yet, it is a country of four parts of Africa. It is a country, if you add the ocean in the territory of Mauritius, it's one of the biggest maritime zones in the world. So it's not so small if you add the ocean. And secondly, we are a country where we didn't have indigenous population. We are a product of the old colonization. So we had 3 centuries of slavery, 1 century of indentured labor, and less than 1 century of non-slavery, non-indentured labor colonial system, and nearly 50 years of independent country. And how politics and how political dynamics express itself in a country like I just described. I think this is an important, interesting question. So just for a bit of history, this country, it's not a society that resembles many other African countries, because it's not a peasant-based society. It's a country that has been constructed on plantation economy, sugar plantation economy, and it's a working-class-based society, historically. And the second most important thing to know is that this is a country where we had our first Labour Party in 1936. Contrary to Britain, where the unions created the conditions for the emergence of the Labour Party, in my country, it is the Labour Party that created the conditions for the emergence of trade union rights and voting rights. So it's a very political country, and quite interesting, very rich political tradition. In the 1970s, we had a very interesting left political movement where we had all the ism, the Trotskyism, Marxism, Maoism, made it. We had it in the 1970s. I'm a product from this time, from the 1970s. And that's for the short history. Because I wouldn't be using slides, so I will use my t-shirt. If you look at my t-shirt, you will see the new symbol of our movement. This is a butterfly. So, 3 years ago, if I would have gone to South Africa, my t-shirt wouldn't be a butterfly. It would have been from 2005 and 2014, it would have been a keyboard in this position, a pencil in this position. When you add it together, it would mean a hammer, and it would have been an R like a sickle. So this was the symbol of the political movement that I belong to between 2005 and 2014. From 2014 to now, it's the butterfly. If you go back further, from the 1982 to 2004, my t-shirt would be a hammer and a sickle. And in the 1970s, I would also have a t-shirt with a heart. That was the symbol of the left political movement. And I was part of the political movement with the hammer and the sickle. Why am I explaining this? Is for you to get an idea of the evolution and the dynamics of the movement. Within the left, social movement, and emancipatory politics in my country, and I guess in many places in the world. Now, I'm my organization is for resistance and opportunities. It's a political organization that has emerged, founded in 2005, and just a brief presentation. We first participated in the election in 2014, and we got 4% of the votes. But the electoral system is a first past the post system, so it's not a system where you have proportional representation, which would have created other dynamics. In the last local elections, we got 1.2% of the votes. It's increasing. And we have a membership of, the average age membership of our movement is 40 years. It's a quite young-based membership movement. And our new women's membership is more than 30%. Our AIDC is about 50% of women's membership. Most of the militants, members, are activists in various social movements. I'm very happy today because I've been in the movement in Southern Africa. That was the number I'm for at least 30 years. And one of the big issues that I had during these last 20 years is that we are not discussing power and politics. I'm very happy today that politics and power is back on the agenda. There was some times in this past 20 years that we were afraid of mentioning the name capitalism. We would say neoliberalism system. Because of the, we had to take into consideration the fall of the Berlin Wall, all the propaganda that came from this. Very, very depressed. Now, in many countries, like in Mauritius, we are witnessing the same situation. We are witnessing the degeneration of traditional pro-capitalist, center-right, social democratic forces. It's happening in Mauritius and in other parts of the world. And what is embracing in this moment of degeneration for me, it's also the consequences of the national crisis, the deepening crisis of the system that we are having. And what is the response of social movement, of workers' movement, of the youth and the left to this critical moment? I think we are in a very, very critical moment. And if we miss the moment, you know, even in South Africa, if we miss the problem, and in many countries, if we miss it, it might be too late if we take into consideration the ecological crisis and the climate crisis. So, in Mauritius, I will speak on the two issues. I will have 5 minutes.
5 minutes ago.
Now, we've decided to transform into better life. This is a political decision that years we left, we rightly, I would say, considered human labor as the centrality of any emancipatory project. Now, because of the new knowledge that we got, good or bad, and because of the centrality of nature and ecological issues in shaping a new society, so we have decided that now it's life that needs to be the centrality. And life means human life, and it means the life of the whole ecosystem of the ecosystem. So this is the symbol why we have butterfly. The butterfly we have it because, you know, it symbolizes diversity. It symbolizes colorful, different colors. It symbolizes transformation, leaves, what revolutions are about. It also symbolizes ecology, and we love butterfly, so it also symbolizes love. Put love at the central issue of any transformation project. So we had lots, so I think I discussed with Bolivian last time it was revolutions. Maybe we are, apart from Bolivia, we're very advanced. We are amongst the first left, we call it eco social movement, no more left as such. When we participated in elections, we had one of the central instruments of transformation in the project for a new constitution and a new republic. And the right of nature was part of this. So the support that we are getting, 4%, 7%, is the support also for the right of nature issue. Second, I will conclude on this point. I want to contribute, and it's one of the contributions of our movement. We come from a society, as I told you, from slavery, with the Wendo indigenous population. So we have population, people that came from Africa, people that came from India as identifier, people that come from Europe as slaveholders and colonial masters. We have people that came from China as workers and small trade. So we have a very important issue in our history. This division along geographical line, ethnic baseline, has always been present in our history. And how do we transcend this problem? So in the years before independence and after independence, we transcended this problem by working people and two people unity and transcend this problem. Momentarily, the pain. But the problem erupts at different times. So we had during our independence time racial riots, ethnic based riots, where people who are kind of sitting in this room will take a hammer and kill his or her neighbor. So we have to face this situation of what it means by ethnic division. In Mauritius, we call communalist division, world is called communia. So we inherited a political system where the concept of ethnic based representation is recognized in the system. Which means that if you have to stand candidates in election, you have to classify yourself within one of the four categories. Okay. For us, this meant that, you know, it started to resemble South Africa. It started to resemble, you know, what happened during the Second World War and the fascism. And many generations has challenged this system. The newer generation, which are part of our movement, refused to classify themselves during elections in 2005. We say that it is the citizen's right for any citizen to participate in public affairs. And by doing so, we have not only challenged the political system, the foundation of the political system, but we are also challenging and redefining the concept. Whether it's good or bad, that's for you to decide. But we are more and more defending and putting on the table of emancipatory politics, the concept of multiple and indivisible identity of human beings. Okay. The fact that states and systems forces to classify ourselves. It's a big problem. When we have been doing this movement since 2005 in Mauritius, it's still ongoing. What do people will say to me that we have spared his children to choose between his mother and father? And from this political action, we also kind of redefine the politics and, in essence, are we even talking about itself? Because this issue of identity politics is a major one which we haven't yet transcended. I'm not saying that what we are doing is the best option. I'm just putting it on the table for discussion in any project of emancipation politics. Just to say that we want a victory. The government has to change the constitution for us to spend candidates in the last election. This was a temporary amendment that was a time to do it. And the next election will be held, supposed to be held in 2019, and they have to change the constitution because the government from the United Nations Human Rights Committee says that this position in our constitution violates Article 35B of the Civil and Political Rights Committee. So the government has an obligation under international law to change the constitution. So if they change the constitution, we will be in the election. If they don't change the constitution, then there will be civil disobedience or imminent revolution. Thank you.
Thank you, of course, comrades. You can ask Comrade Ashton more questions and we open it up to the floor and can expand on that. Okay, Pablo?
Well, hello to all of you. I come from Bolivia, and Bolivia is totally the opposite from Mauritius. First thing, we don't have access to the sea. Second thing, we have a very strong indigenous population. More than 65-70% of the population is indigenous people. We were a colony from the Spanish. And in Bolivia, you have highlands. I live at around 3,800 meters high. But we also have the Amazons, where it's more a jungle, in some cases a little bit more similar to what we can find here in Africa. So, what happened in Bolivia, and the name of this dialogue is the crisis of the left and alternatives. Well, in the year 2000, we were resisting neoliberal policies in Bolivia. We were able to defeat the privatization of water and to build a very strong movement led by indigenous people, by peasants, mine workers, industrial workers. And this movement created some kind of political party. We didn't want to call it political party because we had so many bad experiences with political parties, we call it political instrument for the sovereignty of the people. And because this political instrument was based on social mobilization, in the year 2005, for the first time in the history of Bolivia, an indigenous candidate, Evo Morales, won the elections with 54% of the votes. So after more than 180 years, for the first time, we had an indigenous president. A little bit similar to what happened here in South Africa. It took us all the way to have a first indigenous president. And I was part of the government. We all went into the government. All the social movements were there. And we did very good things. One of the best things we did was to nationalize the gas that was the main source of income of the country. And because we were able to nationalize the gas, suddenly the state had a lot of economic resources. And because of this, we were able to develop health programs, educational programs, give different kind of housing, you increase salaries more than 4 or 5 times in minimum wage. So there were a lot of very important advances that we were able to do because of that. And then we went to nationalize not only the gas, but the telecommunication company, the railway, the rail roads. We nationalized the airports, almost all of the resources. That is the happy story. But the happy story begins to have a problem in the case of Bolivia, which is different, but in other ways similar to what happens in other countries of Latin America. Because in Latin America, we have had governments from the left for the past decade. Each one is different. I'm not saying the story that I'm going to tell you, you can say do a copy-paste to Brazil, or a copy-paste to Argentina, or to Peru, no. But what happened is that in the year 2011, we had the first confrontation in the government. And it was because of the butterfly. We had a position that we even adopted as a law that is called the rights of motherhood. So not only humans have rights, but also nature has rights. It has the right to exist. It has the right to integrity. It has the right to a health system. And we were the country, the government was the country that was promoting the rights of nature, the rights of Mother Earth at international level. And I was one of the persons that was promoting this. That's how I met Corma Kuhlman. And suddenly, they were going to build a road through a national park in the middle of the country. Why are you going to build a road that's going to cut a national park? This is going to violate the rights of the forest in that area. And in this, the indigenous people that live here organized and began to mobilize, and they did a march for more than 1 month. There was repression involved, and suddenly, when the march arrived, it had so much support from the population, but at the same time, the government had campaigned so much against them. That created a split. Some people decided we're not anymore the government, because we cannot say one thing and do another thing. We cannot speak about rights in nature, but don't practice it. We cannot defend indigenous people's rights, and then we are going to harm their home. And what we have seen, because this was just a symptom, in reality at that moment, I didn't realize how deep was the problem. And how deep was the problem is that, yeah, we were able to nationalize the gas company, the railways, and so on. But we were continuing to follow the same extractivist model that we had before in the neoliberal government, and even before, when the Spanish came. Always in Bolivia, how you do it is you extract something and you sell it to export. First, we export silver, then we export rubber, then we export tin, then we export gas. And our aim, when we arrived to the government, was to end up with this model of extractivism for exploitation, and to begin to develop economy for Bolivians, not for the international market. But the government decided to continue this path. Now, why did the government decide? Because it was the best way to get money easy and fast, especially because the prices of oil and therefore gas were raising. So the more you export, the more money you get. The more money you get, the more social programs you can do. So those that are promoting agroecology, come on, you're crazy. That doesn't give you that amount of money like that with the export of gas. So suddenly the government was following a very developmentalist model, based exactly on the same logic. It was very popular. Huh? The indigenous people were criticizing in some areas, but other sectors of indigenous people in the highlands were very happy. And something terrible happened in my country. Probably the most biggest crime that the left did was that we had indigenous communities that had a different vision, not of growth, not to be more than the other. We have what is called the again. So you have to live in a way that you are in harmony with the others, the neighbors, but also with nature. But suddenly, now, what you will see in my country is that everybody wants to consume more and more. And suddenly, indigenous communities in the Andean region that were not consumers, now they are, and a strong consumer. And so this model began to develop very strongly. And of course, the voices that began to criticize that were marginalized. Very, very good. The government followed, why did it follow this path of extractivism? There was no other option. They would say that there was no other option. I think that's not the case. I think they were captured by the logic of power. How does the logic of power work? In the case of Bolivia, the main argument was, if we don't do this, we're not going to have money, and if we don't have money, we're not going to develop the social programs, and we're going to be weak and weaker, and then the Cultural Revolution is going to come back and is going to wipe us out. So we are the revolution. Whatever we do is correct if it allows us to stay in the government. So for example, in the case of Bolivia, he said from the beginning, we are going to end up with GMOs. Evo Morales and all of us were against GMOs. Now we have 90.9% of GMOs in Bolivia in the soil production. Why is it? Because at some point, the government said, hey, are we going to continue this conflict with big agribusiness that wants to export GMO soil, or are we going to go find an agreement? So they reached an agreement. They have the support now of the big agribusiness, and there is peace in that area, but you have GMOs in almost 100% of all the exports. That is the logic of power. You begin to take decisions thinking on what is it that allows you to stay in the government and have more and more power. We had the basis for an alternative plan, like the Bolivia. We had even developed the idea of rights of Mother Earth in the same direction that Ecuador did. But we made several mistakes. One of them was to think that the center of the process of transformation was going to be the state. So, the stronger the state, the better it is. You control the state solves the problem. And that is a big mistake. Because you reinforce that logic of power. So, for example, now, one of the conflicts that we have with the government has the main electricity company. And they want to develop solar energy too. They also want to build huge mega dams that are going to flood the other side. But their idea is, who runs the electricity is the state. And we say, come on. Electricity has to be run by the communities, by the householders. We have to change those consumers into producers of electricity using renewable energy to empower the people so that they are not only consumers, but they are producers. So a different kind of society where you don't have a state that is strong enough that distributes to everybody what they consider is fair or not fair, but a society where you have more self-management, self-organization, of different kinds of organizations that we have in the country. This has created, of course, there is a crisis in Bolivia. The extractivist model is unsustainable. The prices of oil and gas have dropped. In 2014, they paid around $12. In 2016, they were paying only $3. So it means a reduction to only 25%. So, if the left is going to come with an alternative, my final conclusion is, we have to think not only on the struggle against capitalism. It is very important to fight capitalism, but it's not enough. We need to have an alternative that is not anthropocentric, that recognizes that we are part of nature, and seeks to change that relation with nature. We need to overcome this vision, this statist vision, that the state is everything. That is something that the proposal of the commons is sending to us. We have to believe more on the commoners than on the political party controlling the state. And one very important issue that in my country we have done very important things when it comes to law is the issue of patriarchy. In my country, we have laws that are very progressive when it comes to gender equality, healthcare for women, and so on. But we also have understood that it's not only a problem of laws, it's a problem of culture and symbols. Because, contrary to Bolivia, we have progressive laws on one hand, but because the authorities still reproduce machist jokes, sexist practice, in reality, we are not dismantling and patriarchy. So, for us, after this experience of the left, we would say, of course, we're going to continue. But next time, we're going to look at the entire forest, which is not only capitalist, it has to do with these other key issues of nature, patriarchy, and especially the role of the commoners, the role of social movements. Thank you.
It's quite when I come back to South Africa, I'm sort of inspired in the next phase. Because for me, in a way, the struggles against apartheid sort of made me, being inspired by the politics in the 70s, particularly. Because I come from Britain, which is a very small country, actually, with plenty of water, but very small, but thinks it's very big. So the first step for any British, you know, would be leftist, I don't know if Richard could be here, so come away from Britain. Would agree is to realise that Britain is not a big country, it's not about ruling the waves and so on. And the struggle against apartheid was the first lesson that was brought me out onto the streets. And so the way I'm feeling whenever I come back to AIDC or to comrades in Joburg and so on, I'm sort of like almost reporting back how is the struggle developing in Britain, what new kinds of solidarity can we develop. And already, you know, Chris from the students movement, the students without money is saying that we've got to link up between students in Britain and students here. So there's always new connections to be made. So what I wanted to talk about today, which in a way relates to that original, particularly that phase of the struggle, which was about making the apartheid regime ungovernable, you know, recognizing that that regime depended on the complicity of the people. If the people refused, it became ungovernable. And in a sense, that's what the students are doing now in universities. I want to talk about what underpins politics, the old politics, was a particular understanding of knowledge, a presumption that they, the politicians, knew everything, and the people basically were pretty stupid. And so I want to talk about politics of knowledge, and in a sense that too relates to the students, because, you know, as with the student movement in the 70s and the 80s and the 60s, you know, the student movement now is breaking that bond between authority and knowledge. You know, he's saying, hang on a minute, you don't, the lecturers that stand up there from, they don't know everything. You know, we know things too. We can maybe collaborate with some of the lecturers that share our sort of values. But we have knowledge, the people have knowledge, the people have capacity. So in this theme of the crisis of politics and the politics of crisis, where my first sort of theme is that the crisis of politics is that the people are recognising that the politicians are contemptuous of them, and the people are knowledgeable and taking action and refusing to be governed by elites that have got complete contempt for the people, for the voters. And in a way, Tony Blair represented that, you know, most clearly. Really did almost treat people as if they kind of smelled, you know, they wanted nothing to do with people besides sort of shaking their hands and smiling and winning their sort of adulation. And in a sense, what's happened with Jeremy Corbyn, and I'll talk a bit more about him later, but is that actually the people rebel and the elite were completely, you know, taken as time. They just couldn't believe. And Tony Blair and so just could not believe that people could take the future of the Labour Party into their own hands. It's like a living nightmare. And in a sense, what they've been doing ever since, you probably get some of the news, is they've been trying to kind of think they can wake up from that nightmare by just getting rid of him, by just, you know, destroying him. So they really are, you know, all these attempts to, well, this sort of refusal to accept his leadership is really trying to bullying him to submission. People, I know, go to some of the meetings of the MPs and say that it's absolutely brutal. You know, they just behave like sort of animals towards him, just, you know, bullying, being rude, almost, you know, insulting, and they're just trying to sort of wear him down. So it's that kind of recognition of the capacity of the people that he represents. I mean, his whole demeanour, he is, I'll talk later about leadership, because he isn't a traditional a leader who is, in a way, saying, look, you know, I'm listening, I'm sharing, I have to share power with people. But it's difficult to do that from the top. Now, I just wanted to link this question of the capacity of people to the crisis of politics. Well, the politics of the crisis, the second phrase. So I think the other common sense thing that I think can be said is that when people talk about the crisis, a lot of, you know, ordinary people say, well, come on, who's crisis? Who's in crisis? You know, we're not in crisis. We still have our skills, we can still care for people, we still can make things, we can create things. Our capacity is not in crisis. It's the financial system that's in crisis, that won't pay us, you know, that's got no sort of ability to meet or respond to the needs of the people. And so that's leading to a rethinking of economics. And in some of the discussion today, we heard from Laura talking about all the sort of alternative kinds of economics that is emerging in the United States. And I think one difference between the emerging new politics internationally, in a way Pablo also touched on this, and the old politics, is that the old politics, in different ways, social democracy and the Labour Party in Britain, social democracy in other parts of Europe, and I think the kind of regime of in Bolivia, they sort of depended on capitalism. I mean, they, and therefore they encouraged it in a certain way. They presumed that capital or, you know, extractionism would produce the money, and then they were about redistributing that money to the welfare state. So in the end, they were always subservient to capital. So Tony Blair and the Labour Party was always having sort of cocktail offences with the city,
it didn't mean that a scholar would sit in a sharing, you know, shrimp cocktails with business people in order to kind of, you know, encourage them, find out how to make the economy grow, because growth was crucial to, you know, the aims of social democracy, to build a welfare state. And in a sense, the financial crisis has led people to think we can't do things, so we can't rely on capital to provide the funds for our needs. And so people are in all kinds of different ways that are often not recognized by the media or by most traditional politics, are creating alternatives, are thinking, what leverage do we have to create some kind of alternative means of developing the wealth that can meet people directly without relying on the market and on the capitalist market? So you've got the whole emergence of cooperatives in Britain, where there is some left in municipalities. You've got municipalities who begin to think, well, hang on a minute, we're actually, you know, contracting all sorts of services, you know, for the council, whether it's food for the canteens or material for the schools. Why don't we rethink how we do that contracting, that procurement, as it's called? Why don't we open that up and make the getting of a council contract dependent on paying good wages? Or why don't we think how those contracts can go to cooperatives? Why don't we think how that money can be spent within the town so that it's growing the economy of that locality and meeting the needs of that locality? So people are thinking of all the sort of leverages from below and thinking about how to support the different kind of economy that Pablo's talking about. The economy is also about living in a harmonious relationship with nature. And I think that depends on a political process that recognises the capacity of the people, the capacity of workers, creativity of workers. And that entails a very different kind of leadership. I mean, the kind of leadership that you have in traditional political parties of the left as much as the right is a leadership which is based on exactly what Pablo has talked about, that presumption that it's about gaining power in the state and then using the state on behalf of the people. And the complete sort of denigration and denial of power as the transformative capacity of the people. And I think that the model of leadership, you know, is really about how you have a leader who can be elected to be prime minister, and everything is concentrated on the leader. So another kind of attack on Corbyn is, you know, he's not a proper leader. You can't imagine him being prime minister, you know. And I think that in a way that's good. I mean, lots of people, even on the left, are saying, oh, Corbyn's not really thrusting enough, he's not, you know, aggressive enough, he's too nice, he's too sort of gentle. But actually, I feel one's got to stand up because actually it is about trying to show by example. I mean, Mujica in Uruguay, Daniel, Rose can talk more about him, but the fact that, you know, in the end, he doesn't change his house, he doesn't go live in some white house. He just lives in his own home, and he makes it a bit white by putting out the washing on the fence. But, you know, he's still just living an ordinary life, which is showing that, you know, a leader is just an ordinary person. And I think there's a good example in Britain, in Europe, to learn from, in Barcelona, where we have, manipulate this box so I can find my note, my quote from the school. But I wanted to quote what she says. So she says, she says, you can be in politics without being a strong, arrogant male who's ultra confident, who knows the answer to everything. So she's trying to illustrate a feminization of politics. It isn't just about gender and the sense of including more women, but I think that's crucial. But it's actually about learning from the experiences and ways of organising of the women's movement, about a different kind of politics, which isn't simply about being nicer and more female and all this, but it's actually about sharing power, recognising knowledge, mutual kinds of knowledge, recognising you don't know. I mean, women's movement was always about, you know, uncertainty. Sometimes it went too far. I remember women's groups, I was a bit kind of bossy, and, you know. So, and I always thought, oh my God, I have to just say, I'm not sure. Show them you're hesitant. So there's a sort of culture of, culture of shared leadership. So, for example, when we went to speak at meetings, we never went alone. There's always two of us, so we were always sharing the process. So there are a whole lot of things there about feminization or it's almost like a feminist socialism. So it's not about sort of women and a sexual idea of being a woman, but it's about what we learned as we kind of refused our oppression, refused to be complicit in our subordination, and learned how to be confident and to be self-governing, and the importance of building a movement that actually listened to people. So in a way, that whole notion of consensus building, it's got its problems and limits, but it's basically about ensuring that everybody's knowledge is shared and is part of the building of an organisation. And I think that's what Jeremy Corbyn is trying to build in Britain. I think it's difficult, and I think it's particularly difficult to do it from the top, where that's where the elites are strongest. And I think, in Britain there is this attempt to build a movement that is consolidating, the movement that kind of arose spontaneously to support Corbyn once he was on the ballot box of people who are inside and outside the Labour Party. And as Richard will confirm, there's a real tension within that movement, because in a way the old politics kind of goes deep, even amongst people who support Jeremy Corbyn. Many of them, there's a disagreement, some of them are arguing that we should build a movement that's really basically about kind of mobilising people for Jeremy, getting them onto the streets, sort of using Facebook to just mobilise them. So it's still treating people as if they're simply the rank and file to be mobilised, rather than actually recognising that they have capacities, they could be part of alternative economy. They need to be supported. The movement is to find out what their creative input is and build a movement around that, in a way recognising that our power, we do have power, it depends on, it's a result of the fact that the system, whether it's apartheid or capitalism more generally, depends on us. We're the people that are working, that are creating the wealth from which they're making the profits, we're the people keeping the systems going, the transport system, whatever it is. And in a way, the lesson from your struggles about ungovernability is that the first step is refusal. And the next step is trying to build out of that refusal and out of that recognition of power an alternative that's based on the transformative capacity of the people. And that's the big challenge of new politics. I don't know the answer, but that's what we've all got to discuss. And in a way, this box, I've never seen it's a good technology, but it's a good symbol of that, because it's like, you can't keep the authority. In fact, you want to build into this sort of an alarm system, so that after we have 10 minutes, and then we have to check it.
We have that.
For the confidence will begin.
Okay. So now it's up to you to develop those positive alternatives, so I could just check it into the...
Thank you to all the panelists. To be gradually happy to each and every one of you, because I think you were just starting to dig in. But unfortunately, today we can just get a taste. I wanted to make a couple of announcements. There's a thing register going around, and if you want to sign up to stay in the group on what's happening around the new politics platform, there will also be pictures shared on the Google Photo Drive that everybody can access. If you put your email address down, they can be. So I'll pass this around for those interested. The second announcement is to those who are coming to AIDC and going to the conference tomorrow, on Thursday. But if you can please come here with your bags packed and pack up tonight, and come tomorrow with your bags packed and everything, so that it makes the logistics a lot easier for students. Then I would like to open up the floor to comments, questions, interventions from the comrades here. If I don't know your name, I'll point out the item of clothing that you're wearing. And if everybody could take 1 second to say your name and where you come from, that would be great.
One announcement. What we say about the pacemaker is real. So if you have a pacemaker, you better have the pacemaker.
So maybe you'll be tossing this thing around, but maybe we should listen to Ashok and throw it around, lots of love and not identity towards each other. And maybe when you're done, you can just throw it to me and I can chuck it to the next person. So, any hands, any takers? Okay. So, come in the right and the comment in the left. Okay.
Okay. Easy catch. So my question is related to Pablo. Can you give a sense of what is the state of affairs around the thinking of Biondive in Latin American board where you spoke about Bolivia and some of you in the room I read the book Beyond Development and using it quite a bit in my PhD work. A lot of the chapters speak about Beyond Vive. So that's the one quick question. Then my other my comment is on this notion of the Anthropocene and the anthropocentric way of dealing with many crises, but the ecological crisis and this approach around eco-modism, and we can solve our ecological problems by more technology, new technology, greener technology. So, in my own research in environmental humanities, dwelling into this notions of humanity, nature, nature, humanity, away from this kind of separation and the way the world has developed over 500 years, I find that it's not really a big discussion in the left movement and amongst our political economists, but the thinking is still around the political economy, the power of interest, and I'm not privileged to go to your secret meeting, but just some ideas on your thoughts about shifting the debate a little bit to where you both are.
I don't know, I'll take guidance from the floor. Should we allow for immediate responses or should we take a couple? Take a couple. Comment? Yes.
I'm Diego from the Nest Community. My question is going to Babu. Can you please, can you please tell us about the development of Alba movement and the development of Alba movement bank? Because I get that they are opening their own bank. Can you please inform us about that? And what is it that is going to be specific about the bank and the next piece of it? Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Tammy from SAPSU. My question is also going to Pablo. You mentioned something about, Evo Morales, which is someone that I'm quite fond of, and what is happening there also with Hugo Chavez. Now, what I wanted to know is that with the developments that have happened in your country, and the challenges that you have had, how much of those challenges or failures that you have experienced were actually caused by capitalism itself? Because I believe that as leftists, whenever we are trying to do something, capitalism is always there to frustrate or even undermine those developments so that they do not then influence other communities as well, or other countries. So how much of those challenges that you had while you were in government were actually the cause from an attack from the West, like the US and all of those things, to actually make sure that your project does not actually come to fulfillment more than just a failure of you as the government? Thank you.
As Pablo can respond, and we will take the next three. I noted Comrade Mateus, Comrade Moshe, Comrade Liz, I noted Comrade David for the next time. Is three okay with everyone?
Very short to give time to the questions. We have this book. It's in Spanish, but in the web you can get it in English, in systemicalternatives.org. And there, what we think about the UPN is that it's a concept under dispute. So, and you can say that there are two definitions. The definition from the governments of Ecuador and Bolivia is that the UPN is a kind of sustainable development that is more friendly with humans and with nature. While you have a very different position in UPN from others that say, no, UPN is a vision that it's outside the paradigm of development and outside the paradigm of growth and progress. And that UPN has a vision of totality. What is the whole? I would say the greatest contribution of its vision is to think of what is the whole. The whole is the economy. The whole is human society. What is the whole? Or the whole is the earth system. And how do we deal with the whole? What is the main goal? For capitalists, the most important thing is to grow. For the European, for this vision of the European, the most important thing is to find balance, equilibrium inside the whole. And in order to balance that whole, you need to seek for complementarity, not for competition. So I can go for hours, but there is a debate inside the European. You will not find one definition at all. What is happening with the ALBA countries? Well, the problem is that Ecuador, Bolivia, Venezuela, it's a different case, Nicaragua and Cuba, were based, ALBA was moving forward when the prices of oil were high. Because, of course, you had a big income, and Venezuela would contribute to ALBA and to the ALBA bank with significant resources. And there was one good thing about ALBA, the ALBA bank, that it was not done in the logic that I lend you money and you have to pay me with this interest rate. In ALBA, there were mechanisms of complementarity. So, even though you would say those two things are not exchangeable in the market, you would pay some of the diesel that came from Venezuela with production of soil. And it would be an asymmetric relation, which means you give more to the country that has less. So that was possible. And we wanted to develop that. But the source of that was the problem. What was the source? The foundation of that was extractivism of fossil fuels, of oil. So once the prices go down, the whole system collapsed. So what is the future of ALBA now, and the ALBA bank in particular, is going down totally, like the economic situation in Venezuela. So the lesson is, you cannot base your economy on the export of one or two commodities, no matter what they are. You have to have a different approach to the economy, that is more diversified, and then it's not focused on exports, mainly exports. The other question, your question, if Evo Morales would be here, he would say to you, I used to be very friendly with Evo Morales, that everything is the fault of the imperial. Whatever they were not able to achieve is because of imperials. Now, it is absolutely true that there has been several attempts and boycotts from the US. It's absolutely true. But there are some things that have happened, not because the imperialist countries have forced the government to do that. One of the things, for example, the issue of GMO. The government decided to accept GMOs in order to have this alliance with the big agribusiness instead of confronting them. Or the issue of trying to build this road in this national park that created all this problem. Or now the project of building big mega dams that are going to be built by US corporations. If they are going to be built, and we hope they won't be built, they are going to be built by Chinese corporations. In Bolivia currently, and in other countries of Latin America, the presence of Chinese investment is even bigger than US or European investment. So I would say we cannot just say, oh, all our mistakes are because of that.
I'm not sure I'm going to be friendly.
Yeah.
A cheap job. My question is to all the panelists, Mateusz Costa Santos from Mozambique. Thank you very much for all your presentations. It was quite insightful. Great learning opportunity. I'm honored to be here with you. My question is to all of you. And one of the things to me that feels like is a bit of a gap is the way decisions are made, the culture behind decision making, and how that infiltrates and is replicated in many structures from social movements to governments. So my question to you is, what do you see as the role of collective decision making processes? And how this could be an avenue for more representative decisions. So in that sense, perhaps a different approach to democracy. And here, what I'm trying to get at here is that perhaps a missing point is not so much what are the ideas behind the democratic, the development of a country, of a nation, of economy, so on, but the principle and the value that what's most important is to have a truly collective decision, which will then represent the consensus or as much as possible of the majority or all of us. Well, as much of a collective decision-making process is, and how, if you think, that would in some way lead us to better decisions. Thank you.
I can't speak without the mic.
No, but we are live streaming.
Are you live? All right, so my question is about power. And I think this issue is multi-layered and complex, because power and the complexities of power starts before you actually take power. It's how it's constructed in political movements, in social movements, in everyday social relations. And so I'm if we begin to think of rebuilding, reimagining power, I think it takes a whole reorganizing of social relations and society and so on. So, for me, this is critical when you talk about a new politics. Where do we locate that? Where do we start the reimagining of power? So, it would be good to hear from you about that issue. And the second issue is about, I think it's a kind of old political tourism, I suppose, about occupying the state. Do you occupy the state, or does the state occupy you? And I'm always amused at our ruling party here, each time it's this, when they have the opening of the parliament here. Goodness gracious, it looks like a fancy dress party. There isn't one of them who, except now the EFF, who wouldn't think, I mean, this is nothing. They've completely occupied a bourgeois state. They won't even think that they can go in the shorts on a damn hot day. Nothing. So how do you deal with this? This is such a small issue. This is not even a thing about imperialism. This is about our culture, our alternative politics. It's about a new way of doing things, a small thing. And yes, even that becomes bourgeoisified, as if it's imposed on us. To take over the state means dress like a peacock. You know, it's literally like that. How to deal with these small things?
Thank you. I just wanted to say thanks very much for the time. This is my day. I wanted to maybe pick up a little bit on the last point, which is the values that occupy people's minds. And I wanted to ask each of the panelists, this idea of consumerism, which is behind this myth that you can continue growing the economy. And some of you have touched on it, but my question is, maybe the elites can understand that, particularly once they become peacocks. But how does a political movement, particularly maybe dealing with people who have nothing, get through that idea that the planet is not limitless, that the resources have largely been captured by certain elites, and that it isn't possible for every person to have a Jaguar or a fancy car or whatever. You know, like that it's a value system which is captured entirely by capitalism and the companies. How do we address that?
So I have three questions. One about process of decision making. Are we making some new models of decision making? One about power. When do we rethink power itself? And then the last one, growth and limits of growth. The question of how we make decisions, I think, in the US is fundamental. We don't even have a democracy, in terms of how we elect. We have a system that is truly problematic and stacked against us. We do a lot of reporting on co-ops and work around them determined enterprises. And what's so interesting to me is that there are many things to worry about when you take over a business or when you start a business, of course. But repeatedly, in the interviews that we do, people say the most difficult thing is coming to a decision. But they have no experience, except for voting. Our voting system is
stacked, but they have no experience except for the majority of the vote. So it's very, very fundamental to try to figure out how you're going to make decisions differently. On the question of power, this is going to sound glib, but there was something tremendously empowering, although one of you, I don't love that word, but the demonstration the day after he was inaugurated was so rude and so anarchic and so uncontrolled. I mean, and was against, it was led by women who he had just referred to as pussies. I mean, this is a guy who is a predator against women. And he's bringing into office another predator with Steve Bannon, record of beating his wife. This is a people asserting power, particularly against women. And you cannot believe it. I've been watching, I've been involved in demonstrations in the US for 30 years. You could not see the end of the demonstration in any direction. You could not move. We were standing like this, you could not move. You couldn't get off the train because the platform was filled with people. So there was the amount of people who had just shown up. And then their signs, I mean, this is, again, it's a very rudimentary, but the slogans were things like, you're ugly, you're gross, you lost the popular vote. Just like, screw you, we hate you. It wasn't sophisticated, there's problems with that, but on the other hand, it was very defiant and uncontrolled, and nobody agreed to the messaging, right? It was, I think, a moment that people took back power that will benefit us in the long run, because it was an experience of power for people who haven't had it in years. And a lot of young people were involved. So is the thinking around power changing? I don't know, but we did see an expression of reveling in defying power that I hope voted well.
I will answer about some comments on what Matthew's and Immersion said on the issue of power. I think we need also to bring into the discussion maybe the committee or someone will help us. For example, in the way of organizing, in political organization, in trade unions, etc., or social movement, we are used to have structure, organization, collective organization, collective decision, etc. We've been through it, many of us. But now technology is changing a few things. And in fact, some of the fundamental. I give you a simple example. I'm in a political organization. We can have a committee, a national committee, or be discussing some of these issues, and then, 10 seconds after that, you will have 10 members putting comments on Twitter or Facebook about what we've been discussing. Now we have to think about it. How do we deal with this? 20 years ago, I would say this would be an act of discipline, a disciplinary action against somebody who has been kind of violated the integrity, the collective commitment. I don't have any more this point of view. I think this is a dilemma. I'm just trying to respond to the way we organize and how technology is changing some of the paradigm. And how do we address and react to this? Because, people just expressing power on Facebook and on social media. This is power. How do we kind of organize, if you want, this kind of anarchic way of expressing? I think this is a challenge one of the challenges in football of us, and we have to think about. And this create new kind of paradigms and way of behaviors of people and citizens. That's the first one. The second would be to link the question of power and the question of prefigurating politics. And I perfectly agree with many of you, and this is one of the components of becoming verified, that is, in all the social struggle that we are in, we are confronted with one simple kind of reality. We oppose beach grabbing, mainly by some capital, beach grabbing in Mauritius. Now we are opposing the construction of big hotels, and then we get the normalizer. Where to create jobs for the bigger administration. Now, we've been opposing, we had demonstration, we gained support, but then we had to answer, you know, what alternative offer against the building of the big touristic hotels, which would create, you know, 1,500 jobs in this region. And this brings us prefigurative politics and the question of the state itself. So we have to build the alternative land. We don't have a choice. So now we are into the process of presenting a kind of alternative tourism. And we are working on projects, on building projects with the villagers, with the academics from the university, the technicians, the activists, of building a vast alternative touristic project, tourist project, where citizens are part and central to the project, participation is part of the parcel of the project, and ecology is part of the project, which is what's between economy and democracy, to be all together. And I think we need to, this is what we are doing. I'm not saying what is good or not bad, this is what we are. And this also addresses the question of power. We can't just, you know, we stand in elections. We are fighting to stand in elections, but this is not the main instrument of change. We have to build and convince people that there is an alternative. You know, for Hamlet, we are celebrating the years of the Russian Revolution of the whole period. And you know what happened? And we have to convince people that the alternative is possible and is necessary. Unfortunately, they have to see it. And they have to see the living place so that we can create the desire for change. That's would be my and this brings me to the question about values, to what's people's mind. I think we are living in a very interesting period. You know, lots of people would dream to buy a ticket to come to Mauritius. Why? We have to ask this kind of question. Is it only that they want to have honeymoon in Mauritius? Or they want to have something that they can't have in this system in your country? Their desire to connect to nature, their desire to connect the ocean, these are also desires of human beings. And we have both dimensions, consumerism and a growing desire to reconnect to nature. And tourism, what's the thing built more in most countries, is the commodification of this design. So we have both design. And the second thing is, more and more people we've been talking about this morning, we have a desire to eat good food. Okay?
And we should.
But yet we are into this kind of contradictory and dual desire that the society and what we want and what we need. So I don't think I think there are interesting contradictions that are being generated, and it is on these contradictions that new politics need to debate. This would be my response to you.
Can I have one little thing around the growth? Because if you really make me think, I was asked to speak about the reaction to Trump, but the most significant thing that happened in the United States in the last 12 months was the resistance to the pipeline in North Dakota, the No Dapple campaign around Standing Rock Reservation, which spoke to power because you had a mass mobilization of many young people, many people, nothing to do with Native territory, nothing to do with indigenous land. It was the thing to do to go there. They had to abide by the power of the local government, the Native government. The most powerful person was an old-style chieftain whose decision-making had to be final and respected because it became, at heart, this was a question of sovereignty. So you had some very interesting struggles around power and who has power and how decisions get made, but you also had the experience of an encampment that was drawing a line, saying, you will not go any further in destroying the planet. We actually have hit a boundary when you hit our water and we won't let that would put our bodies on the line, and people were, you know, tear gas, icy water. They would still rather be there than anywhere else because they said the feeling it gave them to be in a different way of life and a different relationship to each other. So those two, the Standing Rock thing was amazing.
Comrades, I know we have already reached 8 o'clock. I'm going to ask Pablo and Hillary to respond. In this round, I think we'll take the last round, I think, if that's okay with everyone. I think this is only the start of the discussion and the conversation, or continuation, and it needs to be carried forward in many different ways. So, even though we're running out of time tonight, I think it's a process that needs to be taken forward.
I will focus on the issue of power, but of state power, because power is very broad. The question is, what do we do as left in relation to state power? I would say that there is one position, I see it in the case of my country, and the position is you take state power and you try to take over all the different spaces of inside that state. Because if you don't do it, the imperialists, the right-wing forces are going to overthrow. So at the end, you have governments that come from the left with many good intentions, but become very authoritarian. That is one of the approaches to state power that we have seen. And they justify it. They say, if you don't do this, what do you want? You have back the contra-revolutionary forces? You have another approach that is more the approach from the anarchists. We need to get rid of the state in order to promote self-organized movements, self-organized experience. Any state has is authoritarian, so we have to abolish this. That is another position. You would ask me 20 years ago, I would say that's crazy. Now I would say, we have to take it into account. I don't agree with that, but it is interesting that there is that position, because it's subtracting something from the reality. There is a third position that I see very much in what we would call this some new left that is saying we need to fully democratize the state. So we have to develop different kind of measures like a constitutional assembly, like referendums, like participation at the level of budget, citizen participation, and so on, so that really we can fully democratize the state. And there are those that think that through this kind of measures and others, you can at the end of the day have a democratic state. My personal opinion is that I agree that we need to democratize the state, but it will not be enough. Because the state power in itself has its own law, and it will trap whoever goes into that structure. Whereas it's not here. In my country, no, parliamentarians go with their own drags, I mean, and with their own music. But, and Mercy can say, wow, that's very good. But come on, that is the form. We have to look at the substance. And if you look at the substance, the kind of laws or regulations that they are adopting are not the ones that we want. So I'm less keen to this issue of the form. I prefer the substance. But because what we discuss is that there is this logical power that ain't capturing anybody that even has good intentions. We need to have outside the state power a counter power. Yes. Social movements that are absolutely independent, that are autonomous, that can really do a counterbalance to the state power, that can not only see or be vigilant or see what the state power is doing. You have to supervise the state power. But not only that, you have to promote forms of harmony outside the state. And the state is never going to promote harmony because that goes against the logic of the state. So only if you have a counter power that can have different forms of assemblies, trade unions, of coordinadoras, councils, that really are independent from the state power and whatever political party is in that state power, I think you can maybe achieve some kind of balance. That will not be forever. At some point, I think maybe we will be able to change the structures of state power, but I don't see in the short term we're going to be able to do that. And you cannot say just we abolish them, because you have a lot of sectors, public services, public transportation, and so on, that from now on rely on the state.
Okay, they're really good questions, so I'm kind of thinking aloud and brainstorming when I answer. I don't have any worked out reply. So I'll start with power and then go into decision making, because in a way that's framed by how we understand power, and then link it to the question of consumption, which leads to economic alternatives. So on power, I suppose facing some of the similar dilemmas that Paolo talks about and being critical of the sort of belief in the state as the key centre of change. And that have been sympathetic to some of the anarchist sort of emphasis on the autonomy of the social movements and the initiative and prefigurative initiatives of the social movements. I've been quite attracted to the idea of distinguishing different kinds of power and seeing how they might combine. So I argue that we need to distinguish between power as domination, where that's the traditional kinds of power, including governmental power, power over some people. And then on the other hand, power as transformative capacity, which is kind of what one discovered through the social movement, in a sense through the women's movement. I discovered that power as transformative capacity, we were changing our relationships with each other, with men, with the state, through our collaborative action. And I think that some people say only power too, only transformative, power as transformative. That's the kind of anarchist, change the world without taking power position. But I'd say, power domination can be a resource. The key thing is being a resource for power's transformative capacity. So I worked for the government of London. So in a way, I can't deny it. I mean, I did it because I thought it could be a resource for developing and supporting social movements, not substituting for transformative capacities. Where the point of autonomy is not just a moral virtue, but it's rooted in, you know, where is the power of social movements? In the capacity of the people. And if you destroy autonomy, you destroy the possibility of the movements being able to mobilize that capacity. Because in a sense, the point about knowledge, why I don't know about knowledge, is that in the movements of the 70s, but also now, what you're seeing in their ways of organizing is what they're doing is they're sharing knowledge. They're sharing knowledge which, you know, many people call tacit knowledge, practical knowledge. You know, I was talking earlier to somebody who works with miners, who says, you know, the way the miners, they talk about rock singing, because they know, they couldn't write a geological paper, but they know a certain sound indicates problems with the rock, with the mine. And you see that, you know, in design, in every area of work, that sort of tacit knowledge. But it can be shared, and it's shared through forms of mutual collaboration, through a kind of idea of democracy as productive democracy, as actually creating alternatives. So in a sense, this emphasis on a different understanding of knowledge, sort of practical knowledge, not just knowledge as laws that can be centralized based on statistics, but knowledge that comes through production, through collaboration, through creating alternatives, that's where the basis of prefigurative politics and why we can't think of movements just as being about mobilizing on the streets. I agree, you know, that is crucial, and Laura's description was really, you know, inspiring. That can then motivate you to think, yes, I've got some power. And that then leads on to this more transformative capacity, this actually building alternatives. But that, you know, sometimes you need, I mean, like at the Great London Castle, there are all these property speculators, you know, determined to take over central London, property by the river, build, you know, rich flats and offices. So we needed some political power that could stop that. So we had a few cases where the elected, you know, council, GLC, took over the land using legislation for compulsory purchase of land. So that's important. Took over the land, but they said, look, actually, we don't know how to develop it. The local movements have created alternative proposals. So we'll delegate our power, including resources, funds from redistributing wealth, to those local communities to create alternative forms of economy, cooperatives, and so on, and social housing. So I think it's that combination, but how do you, you know, that combination requires an interruption of the traditional logic of power, it requires the movements to be present in the decision making. But how can that happen without their autonomy being undermined? And I think it does require a different mentality. Some of you talk about what we're thinking in the mind and the culture. So it requires a politics and a kind of mentality of government that recognises the power of the massive, the power of not the massive, individual, the massive that work together, I mean, the power of popular organisations. And has this real belief that nothing can be changed without that combination of that popular capacity and the resources of the state that can be resources for the people using the legitimacy of the vote. So it's going beyond representative democracy, saying that in a way, okay, the decision making at a parliamentary level is one thing, but it's got to be about releasing the productive democracy, creativity at the base of society. And so I think that the decision making has got to follow that sort of logic. So if you take energy, you know, a lot of workers and communities the problems in the energy sector saying, actually, it's not about taking over these national structures, the national structures of nuclear power, electricity generation. At a national level, they're decaying, they're wrong. So we need to have power at a community level, power which is both about communities and about the municipality, and combine that into sort of developing a new kind of localized, decentralized kind of energy. So I think decision making's got to follow the purpose and the kind of power that's being mobilized. And I think that the in order for the transformative capacity to be mobilized, this classic practical knowledge, that power has to be kind of broken up, it has to be collaborative, it has to be about sharing knowledge, about recognizing the different kinds of contributions that people can make. So that's on knowledge and decision making. On consumption, I agree very much with Chuck, talked about, in a way, the sort of unease that, okay, people have got a sort of desire for consuming, and I'm not innocent myself. But they also have an unease, because in a sense, you've got to see consumers, they're part of, if you like, another part of the economy that's never talked about. They're part of the household economy. They have children, they have health problems, you know, so there's a kind of whole area of the economy, right, that's not understood, but yet it's a source of, if not desire, anxiety, concern, you know, and that has led to people exactly being concerned about food, being concerned about their relationship to nature, you know, so if you think about, well, probably anyway, you know, there's all sorts of development which has never been mapped because the official authorities don't really care, but where people are creating alternative sources of food, they're creating alternative relationships with nature in terms of gardens, in terms of urban gardens, you know, in terms of all kinds of different alternatives. So I think that in a way, the politics of consumption is a source of an alternative, or another of these sources of an alternative coming in the figurative politics. So those are just some other complete thoughts.
Comrades, I have an hour of names here, but I think we've gone quite dramatically over time. There's also some food outside for us to eat and then I think discuss further on. So I apologize to the names I've taken, David, Dan Morsley, and Daniel. I will request that we continue this conversation onwards. I would like to say a special thank you to everyone that's contributed to this discussion today, even to those of us who will remain quiet, but it's important sometimes to not say anything. So thank you to everyone for participating today. Daniel would like to make an announcement.
One more thing. Unfortunately, there is a colleague that for sure had a lot to say about this discussion about the state, because she's one of the leading Latin American theories, Marxist theories on the state, attempted by the slave from Argentina. But she will not be able to join us at the conference because of the accident. But we will make sure that she gets the note and we're going to live stream the whole conference. Hopefully, she will be able to participate.
Thanks. Thank you very much.
You are really good.